Good evening and welcome to the June 28th, 2016 meeting of the Pequannock Township Council. Ms. Marsh.
In accordance with the requirements of New Jersey's Open Public Meetings Act, notice of this meeting was included in the annual meeting notice, which was filed in the office of the township clerk, posted on the bulletin board of the municipal building, published as a legal notice in the Suburban Trends newspaper, and distributed to all persons requesting notice in accordance with township policy.
Please join me for the Pledge of Allegiance, followed by a prayer and a moment of silence. Thanks for the individuals serving our nation. I pledge allegiance
to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Most gracious Providence, we ask that you bless this governing body with an abundance of wisdom and understanding, so that every deliberation will result in actions which will promote the common good and the general welfare for all the people of Pequannock Township. Amen.
Next item on the agenda is a presentation for Eagle Scout Tyler Chupakowski.
Excuse me, just roll call. Mrs. Florence Lynch.
Here.
Mr. Phelan.
Here.
Mr. Vanderhoff.
Here.
Ms. Winterfield.
Here.
Mayor Cole.
Here. Now next is presentations for Eagle Scout Tyler Chupakowski. Go front and center, Tyler. Okay, Tyler, we did the proclamation at the church, but we want to make it official for you. So whereas for more than 100 years, the Boy Scouts of America has helped mold the future leaders of this country by combining educational activities and lifelong values with fun, and whereas the involvement of young men in the Boy Scouts of America is of great importance to the community and our country, and whereas the rank of Eagle Scout is the highest honor a scout can attain in the Boy Scouts of America, and whereas Pequannock Township President Tyler Chupakowski has earned the required 21 merit badges and completed a service project for the benefit of the community, building and installing benches for playgrounds at Hillview Elementary School. Whereas Tyler was presented the Eagle Scout Award at a Court of Honor on May 1st, 2016, and whereas Tyler's scouting activities and achievements have brought honor to his family, himself, and his community. Now, therefore, on behalf of Pequannock Township, its residents, Mayor David Cole, and members of the Town Council, hereby recognize the achievements of Tyler Chupakowski in attaining the rank of Eagle Scout. Congratulations. Dad, you want to come up for pictures?
Not like this.
Thank you for recognizing this honor, and I appreciate it very much.
Okay.
Thank you.
Appreciate it, and we appreciate all the things that the Boy Scouts are doing in town. So, number of Eagle Scouts.
Thank you.
Appreciate it. I had a cheat sheet for that. At this time, are there any reports from volunteers serving our community? Joe?
Joe Wells, 5 Washington Street. Just two things, one on open space and one on the bike trail. On open space, a couple of the open space committee members and myself worked on a section of the Riverwalk on Riverside Drive where we cut some trees and cleared the path. So the path itself, where you could walk into it from the very close to the turnpike and finish the end, which is down near the end of the street, that's already cleared. So the next thing we have to do is, with the help of the town, get some signage and benches and so forth, and that would complete the first section of the Riverwalk. Hopefully we could do that before the end of the summer. We'll see how that works out. And we'll also continue with volunteers and hopefully with some help from town personnel after our grant process is complete. we would start on Pequannock and North Pequannock Avenue. And with regard to the rail trail, we've had a setback. We had been working with North Jersey Water just to clarify a little bit, there's a section of the trail as it gets into Mountain View where the NYS&W actually ends their control of the rail, and it's New York Central Rail very near 202 in that area. And so we were going to go over on the pipeline, use the North Jersey pipeline as the route to connect to Route 202 and the rail station. But our negotiations were pretty well underway there. We're talking about paving it and so forth, and I think I reported to the council the method that they wanted us to use for paving, and that fell through. North Jersey did not want to do that. So now we're on a path that is parallel to the rail in a wet area where we're going to need some DOT permitting, but we feel that, I bite my tongue when I say that, this shouldn't be a problem. But any phase of this long and arduous task to build a rail trail always with one change creates three new problems. And so we're still on schedule. The railroad negotiations are okay. The rest of the trail is fine. The environmental studies came out okay. So we just have to get some EPA and DOT approval for that last section in Lincoln Park to complete that.
So they can't do anything prior to that being completed?
They really need to have the entire route approved by every agency that's involved, EPA, DOT, and right-of-way landholders, etc. The biggest negotiation, of course, was the railroad itself. And the entire section of the NYS&W railroad is completed. And they've agreed to sell. We have a price. The price is not for publication at this point in time, but soon we'll be able to say what that is. And the change in the route, safety was a factor where we come out on 202 by the rail station. We wanted to be in one area so when bicyclists came out onto that road, they would be in a safer area. It turned out that our plan to use the water company's pipeline didn't work out. It went very far. Again, in previous cases, the same thing. We went quite a ways in negotiation, looking great, and then it changes. And
so,
we're
so,
at,
yeah,
the southern end is Southern Northbrook, I thought.
Pardon? Yeah, well, there's three rails that come together.
Right.
But the NYS&W, which is the major portion of the trail through our town and would have gone into Riverdale if they had stayed in the program. But at that southern portion, there's New York Central, there's just what you mentioned, and there's a couple of feeders, and it's active to some degree.
Well, Southern Northbrook was a stumbling block years ago.
Yeah. Well, here's what happens.
We acquired permission to do it.
Yeah, well, you're talking about the cross.
Right.
See, what happens at that end, we parallel a rail, but then we're not able to use that rail. So we have to parallel it on ground, and then we cross, and you're right, we do have that okay, and that's a long-standing thing where we're going to cross one of the rails, and it's a tunnel that persists.
So Joe, just to clarify, when did this project start, 1990, what?
I'm trying to think if the first 700,000 maybe Dave knows the answer. Do you remember when we got that initial grant?
Larry Bomber.
Yeah, I'm trying to think. Do you remember, Jay, what the date was?
It's a long time ago.
Yeah, it's early 90s. There had been planning prior to that, and it was going to be a Pequannock period, situation. But a lot of things have happened in the interim between the railroad and the county taking over, and now there's a lot of federal responsibility in the program. DOT is one of the prime factors in this. So, and the cost factor, the $700,000 has been spent in studies, a lot of studies. It's, do you remember the Passaic River Coalition and the tunnels and so forth? We haven't spent $4 million on each project, but we spent a lot of money on surveys and so forth. But I would say there's a value there. A lot of the work that we did and a lot of those things, the environmental work and the route and so forth, we're in pretty good shape there.
It would be great to see it.
Yeah.
I just hope that happens in my lifetime.
I'm even more concerned about that than you are, only because I've got a few more years on you, but otherwise we both agree. All right, any other thoughts or questions?
Thank you, John.
Okay.
Any other reports from volunteers serving the community? Next item on the agenda is public comments. This public comment period will be limited to a total of 30 minutes. An additional period for public comment is reserved later in the meeting. Individuals are requested to limit their questions and comments to 3 minutes. If anyone wishes to address the council, please wait to be recognized. Come to the microphone and provide your name and address for the record. Frank?
Frank Spazzeri, 35 West Franklin Avenue. I just want to talk about the skate park for a couple of minutes. I know it's not on the agenda tonight, but Melissa last week made a suggestion as to the handball court over at Greenview Park. So I took it upon myself to go over there and measure that. It's about 3,000 square feet. Of course, there's a big cement wall in the middle, but that can be taken down. It's already got a fence around it. It's already paved. I know they're looking for 5,000, but you know, everybody's complaining about woodland or where we want to put it on Jefferson, that it's a flood area and all this kind of stuff. Well, that's not a flood area. They might consider, and I know nobody from the committee except for Tom is here, but that's something they might want to look into. That could even be expanded because there's plenty of room there if they wanted to make it the 5,000 square feet. It would be cheaper to do that than to actually build a whole new one somewhere else. So something to consider and pass it on to, Kathy, you can pass it on to the committee and Tom, that they might want to look into that.
I think the thought process, Frank, was that they wanted it closer to the businesses in...
Well, you can't have everything, you know?
No,
like everybody else.
I told
you have to give a little. I mean, I know what they want. And hopefully they'll come up with the money for what they want. But if they don't, you know, then they'll have to survive with bathrooms at least. And they got a place to sit down. They can bring a box lunch. They can sit under the pavilion and have a box lunch if they bring it with them.
Yeah, but the biggest issue, Frank, is visibility. And there's not much visibility in Greenview. Too many things go on there as it is because it's not visible.
Well, how much visibility are you going to have over here by Jefferson? Other than the people that live across the street that are complaining they don't want it.
Visible to the grounds. If you ride over there in a car or on a bike or anything, you actually can see the entire Greenview. You can't see. You can't see in there when you're...
Well, my only thought is you want to save a little money. If the town has to pay for it, I have to pay for it with my taxes. I prefer they go over to Greenview Park where it's already portion of it there. Instead of building a whole new one for $150,000 or $160,000.
Well, that entire thing would have to be renovated. You know, that pavement is like this. It's not smooth.
Whatever. You can always put a top on it.
I don't think that could put a top on it.
Well, okay. That's just my thought anyway. Thanks, Frank.
Thank you. Top?
Thank you, Frank, for those comments, too. Thank you, Mayor and Council. Just to mention, the big wall at Greenview Park, they do use that. We just had our scout picnic at Greenview Park under the pavilion, and the majority of kids took a tennis ball and went over to that big wall, and they played wall ball there. So it's not like that wall is never used. That's really a great asset to the picnic area. So please don't just destroy that. Thank you.
Any other comments from the public? All right, there being no additional public comments, we'll continue on with the agenda. At this time, next on the agenda, ordinances. There are no ordinances scheduled for introduction. Items for resolution. Ms. March.
Public hearing.
Public hearing.
Public hearing.
Yes.
We'll do the public hearing first, how's that sound?
Number eight.
They left out a page, Steve.
They leave out a page, I'm sorry.
Just admission.
Public hearing. Not on my book.
Do you want to borrow this, Steve?
I think it might be later in there, so you might not want to repeat this twice, sorry. So we're ready for this to be read by title. This is a public hearing on ordinance number 2016-10, refunding bond ordinance of the Township of Pequannock in the County of Morris, New Jersey, providing for the advance refunding of all or a portion of certain sewer utility bonds of the township, appropriating $4 million therefore and authorizing the issuance of not to exceed $4 million in sewer utility refunding bonds of the township for financing the cost thereof.
Okay, this is a second reading for the ordinance which authorizes the refunding of our 2007 sewer bond issue. I think in the agenda that was sent around earlier, we had received a revised financial.
We received the revised financial for the resolution.
Okay. So based on current rates, we stand to save about $180,000 in interest total over the balance of the term of the bonds. Comes out to about $20,000 a year. So the numbers actually improved slightly from what we looked at originally 6 weeks or so ago.
I'll make a motion to put it to the public.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Anyone? Are we voting against it?
Yes.
We can do it on the agenda.
We're going to adopt it.
Okay, Carol?
This is a roll call on the motion to adopt.
I'll make a motion to adopt ordinance number 2016-10.
I'll second it.
Roll call.
Mrs. Florence Lynch?
Yes.
Mr. Phelan?
Yes.
Mr. Vanderhoff?
Yes.
Ms. Winterfield?
Yes.
Mayor Cole?
Yes.
The ordinance is adopted.
All right, next on the agenda is resolutions. Ms. Marsh.
I'm going to read all these in order, but then I'm going to ask if you would vote on resolution 2016-134 separately, so we can have a separate vote. Beginning with R 2016-126, authorizing the completion of an application to participate in the electronic tax sale program. 2016-127, authorizing release of designated escrow deposits. 2016-128, authorizing execution of an agreement with the Morris County Cooperative Pricing Council to renew membership for the 5-year period, October 1st, 2016 through September 30th, 2021. R-2016-129, authorizing an interlocal agreement with Morris County for salting, sanding, and plowing operations. R-2016-130, authorizing a grant agreement with the New Jersey Department of Environmental Protection to fund the Green Communities Community Forest Management Plan, which is known as Grant Identifier FS16216. R-2016-131, approving the renewal of the designated alcoholic beverage control licenses. This is for the Pequannock Township Columbian Association and Barty's Grill. R-2016-132, approving the renewal of the designated alcoholic beverage control license. This is for Munar and Dan, which is for the castle. And R-2016-133, authorizing the award of a professional services contract to NW Financial Group, LLC, in an amount not to exceed $40,000 to provide financial advisory services. 2016-134, determining the form and other details of not to exceed $4 million in sewer utility refunding bonds of the Township of Pequannock in the County of Morris, New Jersey, or other such amounts as determined by the Chief Financial Officer to accomplish the refunding on the terms required by the Local Finance Board pursuant to NJAC 530-2.5 and consistent with the refunding provisions of the Internal Revenue Code of 1986, and to provide for the sale and delivery of such bonds to FTN Financial Capital Markets. And finally, R-2016-135, approving payment of the itemized claims as set forth on the June 23rd, 2016 bill list.
Are there any comments on the resolutions from council?
I just want to make one comment. I guess it's on resolution 2016-132. Every year it says the same thing on it. It says special condition stating that no further renewal of this license shall be granted unless the license is being actively used. It's the same thing every year.
Technically, it's every 2 years.
Oh, okay. Every 2 years, I'm sorry.
Do you think that they'll be using it by 2019?
Yeah.
So I guess we're going to
agree
to it one more time.
I think it's like the third time we've done that, but whatever.
Any other comments?
No.
I make a motion to approve OR 2016-126.
I'll second. Could we have a motion first on 134?
Yeah, let's do it.
Oh, you want that one separate? 134 separate? Yeah.
Sorry.
I'll make a motion to...
But you read the first one.
approve 2016-134.
I'll second.
There you go.
Mrs. Florence Lynch?
Yes.
Mr. Phelan?
Yes.
Mr. Vanderhoff?
Yes.
Ms. Winterfield?
Yes.
Mayor Cole?
Yes.
I'll make a motion to approve R 2016-126 to R 2016-133 and R 2016-135.
I'll second.
Roll call.
Mrs. Florence Lynch?
Yes.
Mr. Phelan?
Yes.
Mr. Vanderhoff?
Yes.
Ms. Winterfield?
Yes.
Mayor Cole?
Yes.
Passes. Thank you.
Okay, next on the agenda is items for discussions. Digital advertising proposal, wireless, Verizon Wireless, and
animals.
Resolution regarding domestic animals in the park properties. Anyone have anything that...
Well, don't we want to start with
the
first
one? Let's discuss.
Sure.
Yeah.
So, we received communication some time ago, and they turned it into a more formal letter. This is a firm that does digital billboards. They'd be interested in a couple of locations along Route 23. When they initially approached us, the properties they were looking at were township-owned properties. So,
was this the same company that was in years ago?
When no.
I remember one time there was...
No, this is not a firm that I've dealt with before, okay. They do have some locations in there.
Mm-hmm.
And this almost makes it sound like what they're proposing is that we somehow get some involvement in it, and thereby they don't go to the board and get approval for it?
Well, right now the billboards are not allowed.
Correct. So the Board of Adjustment would have to deal with that, right?
Yeah.
And that would be up to them to bring an application.
Put the billboards up now when we're looking at possibly some type of redevelopment. 23 happens to be anti-productive.
Very anti-productive.
Very
and I don't know why
well,
exactly
it,
they come to the municipality.
Well, because they're looking to enter into an agreement with us for use of our properties.
Which they would pay us for.
Correct.
Which we're not interested in.
That was the
in.
Idea.
Which we're not interested in, if I hear it correctly here.
I don't think at this time. What would be our benefit?
Money.
Yeah.
And we're not really.
I'm trying to understand that a little bit more.
Our interest would be about $20,000 a year in revenue.
Not worth
that,
it.
That's not worth
and
it.
That would be about it at this point.
For how many billboards?
Three?
Two.
Two?
Not worth it.
I don't think so either.
Yeah. No. Where would they go?
$100,000, maybe.
Yeah, what town property are they talking about?
Yeah.
Any
other properties, and is it worth talking about? Like, think they want to come in and just, like, present or something?
I gave them my initial view based on past discussions, and...
That was no.
Yes, correct.
All right.
That I thought they had a long uphill battle, and
okay.
they decided they would send a letter directly to you, because
like
the response they got from me, apparently.
Got it.
The properties that they initially identified were immediately... adjacent to or behind the old Wayne Glass building,
mm-hmm.
and one more north near the All Service Rental.
Okay.
I still don't think it's a good idea.
It's a horrible idea.
Do we agree with, everyone agree with that?
Horrible.
Wayne Glasser is up.
Well, you can tell them that we all got the letter and we have the same response that you had.
Okay.
Next is the Verizon Wireless Sample Resolution, Small Network Node Technology. We do have a representative here from Verizon if anyone does have any questions.
Did everybody get a picture of what this looks like?
If you could, yeah, why don't you,
Richard, right?
No, but that was my question.
Yeah, no.
Richard Commissar, it's KOMISSAR, and my office address is 34 Ferncliff Road in Morris Plains, New Jersey.
If you could show,
of course,
Councilwoman Winterfield and Florence Lynch what the Rich and I saw.
Hey, how come we didn't get a colored one?
We got a colored one.
Oh, we did.
It stands on top there and the equipment goes on the pole. That's a picture of.
So it would go on an existing pole?
An existing pole, correct.
And it's
but
just
this is the whole thing right here?
Oh,
it's
no,
just this piece right here.
Antenna.
Oh, I was going to say, because it's like 2 or 3
radio
feet long.
Yeah, it's a small antenna. The radio.
Oh, this is what the finished product
looks like. Yeah, pretty much. I mean, they vary, but it looks pretty much like that.
So this
would
is
be
already
how many?
Existing.
4 in town?
Yeah, I don't think there'd be more than 4 or 5. It's a small town.
Just so I understand, so this is already existing,
yes.
And it's basically just that.
Correct, and that and that radio box.
And
there.
This radio.
How high is it up from the ground? That radio box. Where somebody can reach it. Right?
No. It'll be out of the way. Yeah.
And where are you thinking of putting them?
Yeah, what location?
Yeah, right now they don't have any set locations. We're looking ahead to 2017, so what we're looking for here is kind of the consent to do it. But however, if there is locations at the Borough feels that there is a lack of service. If you present that to us, we can look to see if there's something we can do there. You know,
just so everybody understands, mm-hmm. We really have no choice, right?
I'm not going to say that.
It's improve reception.
Reset, right.
Yes, it is. The way it kind of works is that Verizon has their coverage here. It's at capacity, so their network is being taxed in some spots, and what we're experiencing is more drop calls and not as good data integrity. So what this will do is, it works in a very small range, it's about 1,000 feet, and it just kind of evens it out, you know, provides a more reliable service in specific areas.
I find that odd because I don't have any trouble with Verizon and Pequannock. When I was with other carriers, I did, but I do in other areas, in West Milford and things, but nothing around here.
I wish, I'm not a technical guy, so I can't, you know, I don't know where the actual spot.
That's why I find
spots.
It an odd request.
Yeah, you know, I don't know.
It that way.
That's the goal for these.
Is it for any other purpose?
No, the only purpose would be for the wireless network. Has nothing to do with Fios or
increase the strength of the wireless.
Yeah, in spots where the network is being taxed or it's at capacity, this would help even it out. Yeah.
And my understanding is that although we might not have a say, as Rich brought up, so to speak, I think you do have a. You can be involved in the process as far as figuring out where is the best locations.
Of course.
If something was to happen to the equipment, you'd be liable. We wouldn't be liable.
Absolutely. Anytime that we actually go to propose or install anything, we'd come back before the town for obviously electrical and building permits. We'll work with you if there's a location that you don't feel is one. You know, we'll figure something out. And of course, we carry our own insurance. If there's a situation where we need to have a road closing, do some work, we'll obviously reimburse, you know, for anything like that. But, you know, we work closely with the municipality and the boroughs to make sure everything works smoothly and seamlessly.
I don't understand when you say there's a location, if we don't want a specific location.
Well,
if the signal is weak,
mm-hmm.
It's either going to go on that pole, it's mm-hmm. going to go on the next pole.
Right. Well, but I was saying if there's a particular part of the borough where you are aware of that there's a spotty service, let us know before we install them. We could look into doing something there as well as in addition to the locations that Verizon may have come up with. You know, again, we're looking ahead. That hasn't been determined yet. We're looking ahead to 2017.
Okay.
We're also looking ahead to more and more people kind of dropping their home lines and moving to cellular. So we're looking ahead. You know, it's the kind of thing where the network, if it's not at capacity now, it will be very soon. So we're looking ahead to 2017 and beyond to make sure that the service stays as reliable as it could be.
So it hasn't been determined that we need them. It's just in case we need them.
I wouldn't be here if they weren't looking at it already. There probably is a need right now. Again, I'm not a technical. I can't say that I'm a technical kind of guy. I'm here just here. But I've been doing this now for 7 months all across New Jersey, and there's always been an issue in the place where they sent us. You know, it hasn't been like, we're just going to go there and put some stuff up just to, you know, there's always been a reason for it.
Yeah, we'd be curious to know what location.
Yeah, of course. And again, before we did anything like that, we would have to come back before you with plans and permit applications, so it would always be transparent as to where we're looking.
Do you have to come in front of the planning board?
No, probably, no. Probably not. What we're doing here is the franchise. Mm-hmm. Right. We have jurisdiction over the franchise because it's our right of way.
Right.
Now, we have jurisdiction over the franchise. We're limited in our ability to tell a utility they can't locate in a franchise, but we technically have control over our franchise because it's in our right of way. Franchise agreements really is about the utility responsible? Are they going to be the kind of utility that is going to be able to adequately manage what has to be done? That's why when we say it's not a bodily way. I think the permitting is probably just through the building department because it's going on existing homes.
Yes.
It's not going on any, there's no new infrastructure.
So I would find it hard to believe that they would come back here and say, which pole do you want it?
Right.
No, well, but I think the point is if we're locally familiar with any locations that are frequently dropped or have poor service, they'd be willing to take a look at those.
That's what I was trying to say. Maybe I didn't say this clearly, but that's it, yeah.
So this is just part of your cellular network? There's no Wi-Fi or anything else?
This has no Wi-Fi or Fios connections, just for the cellular network.
And are there any franchise fees paid back to the municipality?
There are not any franchise fees paid back to the municipality. It's a utility. I believe there's a Utilities Act. The council probably knows better than me, but there's a Utilities Act that says I think that you could actually tax the utilities.
The state of New Jersey has sort of taken that over.
Right, you don't get any.
Yeah. Like I did say, though, if there's any cost that the township may happen to have because due to road closings, police overtime, that stuff that Verizon will obviously, you know, cover, you know. But as far as, you know, like the big cell phone tower kind of thing, it's not like that, you know.
So I'm not going to make up the $20,000 for not having the
billboards. Yeah, we can't help you with the billboards, yeah.
Or the amount that we've lost in the Verizon revenue that they no longer owe us.
Right.
Well, if you go over to Wayne, you can go down Alps Road.
Right, Alps Road is horrible. Yeah. I always lose the calls on Alps Road.
Over there.
Yep.
Well, on Ratzer Road.
Ratzer, I'm saying Alps. Ratzer.
By Vanderman.
Yeah. I apologize, I said the wrong road.
Yeah, Ratzer Road.
Everybody knew where I meant.
It drops there.
All right.
Thank you for coming.
Sure.
Thanks.
Next one is the resolution regarding domestic animals in the... Bob, do you want to...
Sure. I can do that. Following the last meeting, we had some direction from council that they wanted to proceed with an ordinance that followed the ordinance recommended, or the changes to our current ordinance recommended by the Recreation Department. Dave and I talked about it after the meeting. A few issues that we talked about that came up. So I put together a draft ordinance, but I also gave you a memo kind of explaining some things I did a little, really very slightly different than was in the original proposal, based on Dave and I having a discussion. And I think the other piece that I didn't really address, and I show in here, there were a couple things that Dave and I said, well, how does this work, that I didn't really address would be, you know, how are we going to define what a sports field is, or are we just going to say sports field, and are we going to define what playground is, or are we just going to really say playground is what it appears to be, which is that small area with mulch. That looks like a playground. I guess when we come to sports fields, one of the questions is going to be, you know, off the fields, people may have dogs, spectators may have dogs. That may be okay.
Well, no, they're not allowed at sport large events.
On the fields. Well,
they're also not allowed at large events.
And that's another question. What is a large event? Is a ball game a large event?
Mm-hmm. I'd say so, yeah.
Well, the shelter is right where
Washington Field is, mm-hmm.
and they kick the dogs out while they're playing. That's the only time they have to walk them.
So we would define a large event to include all the ball games, and that would be a time when dogs weren't permitted at all in the park? Is that what the thought process is?
Or here are the ball fields, but we still need to clearly define, delineate what a ball field is. I mean, does it include the bleachers or not? Does it include the outfield or not? Does it include the foul ball area or not? Soccer ball goes over the net into the Greenview parking lot, and the goalie has to go chase it. Are they getting chased by a dog? I don't know how to define some of these things, and they're going to be great.
I personally think we're making this overly complex.
I do, too.
Mm-hmm. Way over complex.
It needs to be where the crowd would normally be watching a game, right?
I think we need to
try
step
something.
Right.
Right.
And look at this
try
next
something.
Year.
Should we do it this way and then see if they have issues?
Oh. I think
the park ranger is going to have to give us some feedback as we step through this process.
You mean after we've adopted it?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Yes, I agree with Kathy. I mean, really, because you could over-define this thing, and it becomes useless. And we're not trying to penalize people.
Well, the feedback is, and Park Ranger and I discussed this after last meeting also, if it's gray, if it's not clearly defined, it cannot be enforced. You can't go before a judge and say, well, he was in violation, and the person says, well, I wasn't actually on the field of play, and I didn't know where the delineation was. That is always going to go to the benefit of the offender who's been accused of doing something wrong, always. So it becomes unenforceable. So we're either going to have some type of clear delineation that can be enforced, or we have an unenforceable ordinance.
Well, then we have to say something about the games, then. When a game is in play, no matter what the game is, there's no dogs
on the field.
On the field.
I mean, I think you could certainly take Dave's right.
Or within 100 feet of the surrounding area.
Right.
Of the field.
I think
but
you're
we
gonna,
could
yeah.
say,
I think you're
let's see if
up
it's
with
a problem.
Feet.
Yeah.
I think we need to try something. I think it should not be that restrictive in the beginning. If it doesn't work, then we can tighten down on it. I realize there's gray areas, but, you know, it's like our smoking ordinance in the park. If that's right, five people smoking in the park. Mm-hmm. People are either going to do it or they're not going to do it. Am I getting a disagreement or agreement out there?
What's the verbiage?
Something. Do something.
Right.
It's like the fifth meeting already.
I
where can we walk?
Oh, I have another question.
But we enjoy having you here.
So when I pulled up, there was a gentleman walking his dog right here. No bad, no nothing.
Again,
right
I know
what
it was.
Again,
he might have just.
Right. I think we need to come up with something, and then as time progresses, if we have to tighten up, we tighten up.
That's why we need a definition of field.
Well, I would say sports fields includes, it does include those boundary areas. Maybe you got to put that in parentheses, Bob. I don't know what you got to say. Sports fields, it does include.
Could be Washington Park, any grass area of Washington Park, 1, 2, or 3.
Mm-hmm. Maybe we have to have some little maps that show the sports field.
And we have to paint red lines in there in the park, right? Blue lines, green lines.
Well, maybe not in the park, but I'm saying in the ordinance it should say.
Right. Out of bounds. Crazy.
I don't know who said it, but 100 feet of the playing field with 50
right, something
feet
like that, within 100 feet of the playing field.
Okay. You got some people with hands up out there.
Well, I think
maybe we should try to discuss this and try to get it worked out before we start hearing stuff from the public.
Mm-hmm.
Bring us if we don't agree upon it.
Yeah. I have another question about the service dogs.
100 feet's a lot, don't you?
And I might be just getting too reading into this, but you could have a service dog and not need a service dog. And you just bring your dog, a certified, and you just bring your dog to a game. Is it a service dog? Is there some kind of certification about the person needing the service dog? Or is it just, I just got my dog, qualified to be a service dog, and I bring him in the park? Right?
Service dog has to wear.
Because it seems like everybody's getting their dogs certified to become, emotional type, therapy dogs and all kinds of things. I don't understand.
I think it's so hard to try to define that more and to try to be more limiting than that.
All right.
I hear it. And I guess if it becomes an abusive situation, we may revisit
Rachel,
it.
We'll have to get feedback.
As Rich suggested, we can always revisit if we're getting abuse in certain areas.
Okay. I think it's a really good step in the right direction. Is it perfect? Probably not.
So are we going with 50 or are we going with 100 feet
50.
From the ball?
100 is too much.
50 is 50 feet of the field?
I'm fine with that.
Of the playing field, I guess I said.
The playing field.
Okay. Right.
the end of the
field. I don't know, I'm asking, is that what you mean, the end of the playing field?
I assume, right, 50 feet from the end of the playing field, from the boundaries of the playing field?
Boundaries of the
field. Boundaries of the playing field. So if it's a 90-foot field, then you go...
Okay.
50 feet from 90.
But I don't like that.
So that helps the ball fields. What about the playgrounds?
First of all...
Playground's a playground.
That's true. Yeah, once you're on it, you're on it.
Right.
Right. Playground's a playground for
crying out loud. It's got a swing and a slide in it. It's considered a playground.
Right.
Bob, you also mentioned that we didn't allow PV Park.
Well, I did change in this draft. Yeah, I changed it to read the portion of PV Park enclosed by fencing. And I did that because, there was a lot of talk about Woodland Park and where those boundaries are between the two. Yeah, again, it's just being overly technical, but if they're, it's real. I think what everybody has in mind is the portion of PV Park where people go and swim.
Right.
And to access Woodland, you need to go through the parking lot in PV Park, and to walk around Woodland, you need to probably. You might, depending on where you go, but that's.
I'm fine
with doing, just changing that. Just that
enclosed portion. Just enclosed portion.
So you're saying they can walk on the fence?
Yeah, I'm fine with that.
Correct. They can walk on the path, just not within the fence.
That makes sense.
And that makes sense that they should do that.
Within the fence area. Then we just made it any indoor location. I mean, there's no reason to bring dogs in the bathrooms in the park or anything anything like that either. So we just made it clear that way. And we use the term special public event being held in the park. I think people had in mind was the hoedown, but there are probably others.
Sure, there's other things that happen.
Special events as determined by the town.
As determined by, yeah.
I'm not going to do that too.
Yeah, that's fine. You can't get to.
Are there any gray areas there that you might try to work out now? Or?
Well, I think the ball field is one of the most critical ones.
Okay. Mm-hmm. So 50 feet surrounding the ball field.
Right.
The other thing I added to this, which I did get from other ordinances in other towns, most towns say, regardless of when they allow dogs in your parks, the dogs must be under control of the person. So they have to be on a leash, but they have to be also held by somebody who can control them.
Right.
So it's a violation of the ordinance for you to take a dog in the park that cannot be controlled.
Right. Like the dogs walking the person.
Well, but by control means the dog can't pull the leash out of the person and go running at large. And really is a way of saying, you don't send a 5-year-old in the park walking a large dog.
Some towns have ordinances on how old the child
is. Yeah, I think I like rather control. Than trying to do that, just say the dog needs to be controlled. That protects us.
Right.
We don't let you bring a dog in the park if you can't control the dog.
Right.
And that's a pretty standard standard thing. And again, leash or other similar restraint, just added or other similar restraint, because I think some people have things that might, let me get into what's the definition of
a role for
you're holding the dog and it's properly, and that's what it's in mind. That's it with the 6-foot requirement, which we added in there. I think that
everybody else all right with what's going on?
I think it's a good place to start.
So, see if we can get it ready for the next meeting?
Definitely.
Okay.
Joe, you still have come on up, Joe. Wells. And Joe, I'll get to you right next.
Joe Wells, 5 Washington Street. I also, as the town attorney, reviewed some of the local ordinances. I said at a couple of previous meetings, every town around us, Wayne, Lincoln Park, Duaco, Riverdale, they all have allowed dogs in the park. And they've all figured out pretty simply that they allow the dogs in the park, and then they just make a special, if you read the ordinance, it'll say dogs are allowed to park except on the handball court or by the swimming area. And I think you've come to that, pretty much that conclusion tonight. I'm surprised that it's taken this long to define those things, but in any event, I'm very happy that we have reached the point, and my question is, we'd be voting on an ordinance at the next meeting.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. We would be introducing
it at the next ordinance.
Okay.
Voting on it on the
following meeting.
Yeah.
Right. Okay, no, I find that.
But we could introduce and put it in on first reading, couldn't we? We've done it. No?
Do you?
It just seems that we've belabored it quite quite a bit.
Don't really have a draft.
Well, not really. We didn't talk about it all.
No, no, it's not. We met there next week.
Oh, yes.
Next week. Next week.
No. You have to introduce, then you have to publish, then you have to adopt. It takes to meet.
Okay.
Okay. All right, thank you.
It will get done, Joe.
Okay.
You have a fruitful. Joe?
Joe Jorgensen, 14 Meyer Place, Pumpkin Plains. So, I heard that it's going to be 50 foot from ball fields.
Yes.
See, the one thing when you're drafting the ordinance is it's very hard to make blanket requirements when you have all different conditions on every ball field in town. So, if you say 50 foot from Washington Park. That means if somebody from the dog pound wants to walk down the street and go past Washington Park, they're in violation because they're within 50 feet of the ball field. If you're counting the fenced-in area, you know what is the see part of drafting the ordinance is also adding some definitions to your glossary of terms of what's what, because you are creating a gray ordinance by saying 50 foot from a field. If you're down by Greenview Park and you're by the soccer field, what's the 50 foot from? There's no fence. There's, you know, it's not always lined. You know, you're leaving it up for the discretion of the ranger, but you're leaving it open for any kind of court case that you go to. So I think you have to, you know, you basically have to just say not on the field. Once you start putting limits to what the field is, you have to have that field defined very specifically.
Yeah, I think
if you defined, let me just finish all my thoughts and then you guys could respond. You could define each field in of what you have, but I think you're way overcomplicating it. And, you know, in this day and age, you do have the exceptions for, you know, like CNI dogs and, you know, companion dogs or whatever, but now you have to deal with, you know, comfort animals. If somebody has a letter from their doctor, I mean, there was a thing on YouTube, a lady brought a turkey on a plane because it was a comfort pet. It's so out there with the stuff that's there that if you make it very specific, you may get somebody challenging it, or you're going to have, the ranger's going to have a hard time enforcing stuff. So keep it simple. If you want to define stuff, do it in your definitions, you know, not necessarily in the ordinance, because the ordinance, each field is a different condition. That's the problem with a lot of ordinances. It's a blanket coverage, but it doesn't specifically address every situation that you have. You leave a lot of gray areas that way. Rich,
I think we're trying to make it. I truly think we're trying to simplify it as much as possible.
Yeah, but the 50-foot creates a problem.
I kind of agree with you that it could get to be a problem in certain areas. Maybe what we want to do is go with your suggestion, and if it doesn't work, then we'll come back and review it again next year and say, oh, we have to put a 25-foot or a 50-foot in there because it didn't work for whatever reason. I think we have to keep it simple.
If you look at a lot of the other stuff on the books, is, you know, people have to be, you know, responsible with what they're doing with the dogs. The dogs have to be on a leash. You know, I don't think there is any exception anywhere in town. People take them up to Mountainside Park and let them off lead and whatever, and people let them off lead on the ball fields on Sunday morning and play ball with them. But they're in violation, so you're covered with that. You don't have to specifically address that again. You're covered that. I think everywhere in town, am I right, Dave? I don't think there's anywhere that, besides the dog park, that you could take them off lead.
No, that's correct.
So a lot of stuff is already covered. It's just make the enforcement as easy as possible for the ranger.
We could say ball field or where the spectators are present.
But you have to define spectators. One person's a spectator, Dave. that's what I mean. It's so hard to overcomplicate it.
Why don't we start with ball fields?
Yeah, start with ball fields.
Let's start with ball fields and we'll go from there.
Yeah, that's reasonable.
What's the ball field?
Use common sense.
If you're playing a game,
there's as much gray area in that as there is in the, you know, 50.
But Joe's right. How can you say 50 feet from the end of the ball
field? People have their
rules out. Well,
if you say ball field, where's the ball field?
Where they're playing ball with the one spectator.
Well, when they're playing a game, they know where those things are.
Within the boundary limits of that field. Your baseball fields.
Back to your statement, Joe, sometimes the lines aren't there, so where's the field?
Well, then you put on with the judgment of the ranger, because he should know approximately where the fields are. You know, if the person's like right on the edge, you tell him to move back and you give him a warning. I know, well, a lot of this stuff is not fair, you know, but we're trying to come up with a solution.
We have to start with something and then...
And see how it goes.
Because you also have to look at, you know, put while there is an active game, because there were some people initially at the Parks and Rec that Sunday morning, before there's any kind of game or anything, they go out on the field, and I think they do take their dog off the leash, so they're in violation. Mm-hmm. But they throw the ball, the dog gets some exercise, puts them on the lead, and goes home. There's no one on the field, you know, so... You might want to consider putting something if it's an active game.
We're not allowing dogs on the field, period.
They're afraid they're going to relieve themselves. And then when the kid comes
but you're already covered for that, though. Mm-hmm. You're already covered for that. Well, you're not getting any more fecal matter than the Canadian geese that are roaming all over the place. They're more of a problem than one dog. So that's just my two cents on it, but don't overcomplicate it or define it in your definitions. Don't define it in the ordinance, define it in the definitions.
Right, but all the citizens that were here testified, this ordinance is not a problem because they all abide by the rules. So there should be no issue down there.
Yeah, but the 50-foot, as I was listening, you know, you're creating exactly what you wanted not to do. You want to make it easy for the ranger. So... Washington Park, you can't have 50 foot from Washington Park. It's surrounded by a road that's 20 feet away from the fence. I might be wrong on the distances, but I think if you're walking down the road with the dog,
well,
your ordinance is in violation of the ordinance.
We don't say park, we say sports fields.
Well, the sports field is within 50 foot of the road.
Well, there's still other parts of Washington Park because
I don't think you could ticket somebody for walking a dog on a public road. So that's where your ordinance is in contradiction. Bob, am I out there?
Ticket somebody. This only applies to parks. So right. You wouldn't have to worry about the public roads. Because this only, it's only parks where we don't allow it.
Right.
Public roads don't get to this. It's only parks.
This is a
well, the wording was 50 foot from a
field. Park. It would have to be within a park. And you're right. I mean, if it was 50 foot outside of a park, it would not apply.
No, it's from the
okay.
field.
Okay.
Yeah.
We can start with something, and we can...
Do you want 50 feet? Does the council want 50 feet, or do they want just to say sports fields?
I like the 50 feet.
I like the 50 feet.
Okay. Let's get something, and then we can do an ordinance, or
okay.
Yes.
We're going to do something to
it. Hi, David Castle, 12 Dairy Drive. On the 50 feet thing, I'm going to just add my voice to this gentleman here. If you think about 50 feet, that's the length of this room. These are 2-foot tiles. It's pretty far. It's a far piece. Woodland Lake, we're talking only about ball fields, right? The playground, you can't walk past that playground, and you have to be within 25 feet to stay on the path to get past the playground.
Where Woodland Lake?
I'm talking about
Greenby Brook,
right? So, but I'm just using that as an analogy here. I can't get past that playground if I'm 50 feet away from it. 50 feet is not reasonable. It's going to be so restrictive that it's going to negate being able to walk your dog.
I thought we were talking about sports fields.
I know, but I'm using that as an example. We don't want people within 50 feet of sports field because of the possibility of human contact, right?
Yeah, because a ball can roll outside of the field.
Right.
So in Greenview Park,
if
you're walking down the path,
I can't.
You're walking down the path.
Yes.
As long as you don't bring your dog into the playground, you're fine.
But I am adjacent to the play. I'm drawing an analogy for you folks. Is that 50 feet is?
And I think in both cases, in both Washington and the Greenview Park, you know, we've got a situation where we've got a pedestrian traveled surface, I'll call it, the pathway. Right. It's a paved pathway in Greenview, it's the roadway at Washington that will be within or potentially within the 50 feet.
And that's why I think the
so
50 feet is...
I think the 50 feet is still valid around most of our playing fields because I look at Hillview Fields. You know, all of the activity is occurring within that.
Yeah.
Whether it be the kids that are waiting on the side of the field or the spectators or whatever. So maybe the solution is to say, okay, 50 feet, and then have an exception to the 50 feet for paved paths.
Okay. Going back to this gentleman's suggestion about keeping it simple, don't put a footage on this at all. Leave it enforceable by the ranger. He can define the playing field, right? If you, and here's why I'm suggesting this, 50 feet, I'm almost can't be on the other side of that
ditch
and be without being in violation of a ball game playing. However, I'm clearly not within the playing field. So if you had an event, a sporting event, and the Rangers came up to a guy that's standing
25 feet?
No, I'm not happy with any footage.
I think it has to be defined because I don't think anything will be
the okay. Ranger's not going to be able to.
The Ranger can't, yeah.
But you said there's a ball game here. There's no dogs allowed on the field. Doesn't that seem like a reasonable thing? In the case where there's no dogs allowed on the playing fields, no animals allowed on the playing fields. That goes for the spectator areas. That is a definition that's enforceable. The spectator areas. That means all of the people that are sitting there with their families watching the games, and some guy comes up with his dog and is standing there next to somebody else, that ranger's got a clear definition. This is a spectator area. You need to move along. If you do footage, you're really making it so restrictive that people won't be able to walk their dogs in those parts.
I don't think it's fair to put it all on the ranger because the ranger can't be in places.
I understand.
Right. I think any rational person, whether you're the dog owner or the person without the dog, needs to be able to reasonably understand where dogs are and aren't permitted without having to call in a third-party referee. Because if you're
legislating to the lowest common denominator, right?
You have to make it yes.
And I understand that, but that's why we got to be careful about not making it so restrictive that you might as well not even have the ordinance on the books. So anyway,
we got to start somewhere.
Thanks for listening,
Sharon.
Sharon Taylor, 19 Libby Avenue, Pompton Plains section of Pequannock Township. I just have a question about that. I'm getting all confused. The verbiage that you have, is it within walkable or stopping? Because there's a big difference if there's a ball game playing or some kind of activity and you're walking your dog on a street that's 50 feet away from something versus stopping and watching. Yeah, so all I'm saying is I can understand that you would be asked to leave if you're stopping, standing, and watching. But if you're just walking through, even like Greenview Park when a ball game's going, and you're on that pathway, I mean, it could say 50 feet in the ordinance, but it should be more entailed for somebody just stopping and watching, like a spectator.
You're on the pathway.
That's all, because I'm getting all confused because there was... Yeah, because I can walk my dog. All right, I can walk my dog while ball game's going on. Even at the high school, I walk on West Parkway. So 50 foot from the track, there could be a running race going on. That's probably 50 foot from there, right, or close to it.
Yeah, but as long as it's not.
So you're walking, right? But you're not spectating. I'm not standing, or I'm not going on the property watching. But it's the same thing if you're at Greenview Park or Washington Park, and you're not standing. You're just, you know, walking through. So is that what it says on there?
It doesn't say stop. It just talks about dogs the animals are either permitted or they're not permitted in the area. And right now it says, the draft says sports fields. So on the sports fields, and then the discussion really is, do we not allow them within a certain area of the sports fields?
I like this.
I would just say, like, not spectating. You can't stop and be a spectator.
Can we say with an exception?
No dogs in the park while ball games on, period.
Yeah, like, if you're walking through a pathway, I mean, why not? I mean, I think it's getting too detailed where, like you were saying, just keep it.
Yeah, well, that takes care of PV, too. If you, like he had mentioned, walking around PV, you're on the opposite side of the chain link fence, but you're closer to 50 feet.
And then on there, would you have, like, with the exception of the park ranger or a township official, if there was a problem, then they would be the ones that would be able to say, you need to leave.
Yeah, you can't
do it.
Unfortunately, we're not allowed in an ordinance to give discretion to somebody and say when they say.
Okay.
You've got to put in here what the rules are, and they have to...
I mean, I'm just saying, me personally, I would view it as if you're 50 feet and you're stopping and you're watching a game, or you're just stopping and standing. Even if you're walking through Greenview Park, if you're on the macadam there and there's kids even on the playground, there's a sports thing going on, you're just walking through there.
You're fine.
And you're on, you have your dog on a 6 foot or a 4 foot or 5 foot leash, there's no reason that you're hitting, you know, a violation.
So we say, or within, we use 50 feet from the boundary of the sports field, except for paved walkways.
There you go.
Right, and then try it, and then for a year and see how it goes. If there's a problem, then you can enforce it more. Yeah.
Maybe not paved.
That's a little, I just had a question.
We're good with the 50 for now. Yes. Good with the 50.
Okay.
Okay. We'll get it in the ordinance form so we can
pull
it out.
Introduce it. Yes.
I'm not going to talk about feet. Kelly Delia, 492 North Pompton Turnpike. On a positive note, I like the idea of working with Parks and Rec and maybe even volunteering. If you give enough police presence in a crime area, it actually lessens the crime. So if we can get a good group of volunteers with safety vest, Park and Rec volunteer, we could help Ranger Sean possibly help enforce the rules. If we get more garbage cans up, dog waste. Maybe we could do some courses like I've done in the past where we go into the schools, dog bite prevention, responsible pet ownership courses, mail outs to everybody that owns pets in home with a list of pet responsible pet ownership. These are things that have worked in the past in Silas Conduct, in Ramapo Reservation, and in residential areas also. So I'd be more than happy to volunteer to help make this work, be proactive. Liability issues, you are out there. You're teaching people responsible pet ownership. You're not just putting an ordinance out there that's going to allow people to walk their dogs in certain areas now. You're getting proactive and you're help educating the public. That's all. And I'd be happy to volunteer.
What we need to do is get the ordinance, or a draft ordinance in place so that we can really tweak it some more. I mean, we can talk about it till midnight tonight.
Any other comments about the dog park, you can talk about it in the public comment section later in the meeting.
Okay.
Okay, so we're good with that.
Just to note, I'm also going to add the part about the increased penalties.
Yeah, that was my question.
You wanted the last one?
Yes.
Yeah. What was the decision on the fine?
50 for the first offense. Let's see, I was running it larger. The first offense would be $50, second offense, $150, third offense, $200.
That's good.
As long as it's consistent.
Fines for
the offense you have.
Unlicensed. They're pretty hefty for unlicensed.
That's what it is now.
These are existing penalties.
Those are all existing.
But there should be, I think, anything new.
We would
like to see them enforced.
Right.
Well, once we get this working, we'll be able to do that.
All right, let's get it in an ordinance form, and then we can all look at it, and we can vote on it, and go from there.
Okay,
next on the agenda is reports and notices. Are there any comments and questions from council on these? Mr. Holberg.
Due to the Independence Day holiday on Monday, there will be no recycling collection on Monday, July 4th. Recycling collection will resume the following Monday. Vegetative waste will be collected on Tuesday, July 5th. Residents are advised that collection may be later than normal due to the contractor having an increased workload. That's something we've experienced in the past on Tuesdays, and we tend to get a lot of calls because things haven't been picked up when people are...
Possibly even the next day.
And possibly even the next day. Comparative year-to-date PV Park registration revenue numbers are attached or on the back of this. Registrations are up for the second year in a row, and year-to-date we're looking pretty good.
That's great.
Both Sunset Road and Boulevard sidewalk projects will begin next week.
You think we're going to be okay with the sunset time frame? It's going to get done before school starts? I think so. Next item on the agenda is council reports and announcements. Councilwoman Florence Lynch.
All right, just a couple quick things. There'll be a presentation for seniors and their caregivers that is going to be given by our own police department. It'll be on senior scams, what to look for, how to protect yourself from fraud and scams, you know, what to do if you're a victim. They'll also use that forum as an opportunity to help collect old medications, so the seniors can bring their prescriptions, old prescriptions, in for proper disposal. And that presentation is going to be on Wednesday, July 27th at 10:30 over at the seniors. What else? The library meeting, our library board meeting, is being moved to the fourth Wednesday of July as opposed to the third. So, Carol, can you make sure that gets up on the website, that change?
Yes.
It'll be moved to the fourth Wednesday just due to vacations. And I'm
just this one meeting?
Yes. It's always the third Wednesday, but it's going to be moved to the fourth Wednesday of July. What else? I think we mentioned this last time that the Shred Day is October 15th. Just a reminder. And that's really all I have right now. I'll let the mayor probably tell you about the fireworks. So I'll let you do that.
Councilman Fallon?
I don't have anything.
Councilman Vanderhoff?
A couple notes, things for the council to think about. I was suggesting that the Citizens of the Year become a council program. We certainly deal with the public. During the course of the year, we come across a lot of people dedicating a lot of time to the township and projects and whatnot. I would do it on the same format. Originally a Rotary program, then they stopped it for a few years when they had no one to nominate. Then it's been picked up. I think it really should become a counseling program or event to do.
I tend to agree with Jay on that. I think it's a good idea. I think we should take it over.
I think we should definitely discuss that.
Yeah. Well, we wind up giving the award anyway.
Right.
Proclamation.
Right.
Right.
Yeah, and we don't pick them up.
But we don't have any input.
Right. And we do get to see the people who are really out there working, helping the town. So.
So maybe we could do some kind of hybrid thing too, where we do it, but it's like in conjunction with, you know.
Exactly.
We would be involved in the conversation.
Exactly.
Yeah, it could be jointly done,
it's
but
kind of,
there should be more involvement.
It's secret, and nobody knows who's on it.
Exactly.
It's like all of us.
Yeah.
That's it.
Councilwoman Winterfield?
I don't have anything to report, but I do have a question for you, Dave, about you know, the recent thing in the news about the legislature and the gas tax.
Yeah.
Would the gas that we purchase, would that affect us that we buy in bulk?
For municipal? No.
Oh,
no, we don't pay state tax.
Okay.
Or federal excise tax.
Okay, good. I was just wondering about that. And also, we had a lot of talk about, you know, the license for the renewal of Dan and all that, but we haven't had an update on the project in a long time. Can we get one from Joe?
Yes, we can. I know that we had discussed that. They're moving quite rapidly, so by the the last time I got information, it was stale by the time I would have reported it.
Okay.
They are moving quickly, and I'm trying to get, I mean, the most important thing, I think, to most people is when.
Well, the most important thing about that is that we're ready with our, you know, with our fire and ambulance, and if anything's event going on there, so, you know, we need to be prepared.
I don't have an updated estimated date of opening since the last time I reported, which was mid-2017. So I'm trying to confirm whether that's still a realistic time frame.
Yeah, because I would think we would want to go in there and do drills or at least get familiar with
Yeah, the emergency services fire department has been there a couple times. I imagine they will be going back. They were there shortly after the framing and the walls were up. There wasn't a lot for them to do other than test out distances in the driveway and heights of the aerial apparatus. But once some of the interior walls start going up, they'll be back.
Dave, who is the contact over there? I have a lot of residents always asking, like, oh, I want to start booking a wedding, you know, 2 years
trail,
from now. Like, is there a trail over there?
There is a trail. I don't know that they're keeping regular hours.
Yeah, I don't think till they get closer. They, you know, have a vision of the date. I mean, June next year's vision. September is probably more realistic.
Was there a number calling you outside?
Is there a number on the building or anything?
So right now, there's no known bookings of the first events.
They want to get, enough inside so they can say, we're 6 months away.
If you want to book 2020, you could.
Well, that's the point. They want to know who they can contact.
I guess nobody
yet. No one yet.
Right, there's electricians there, there's HVAC guys, fire sprinkler guys, so all the utilities appear to be going in. So, there's a lot of vehicles there.
There was a lot of conversation at the EDC meeting about that too, just with the anticipation of them coming in, is there somebody they can reach out to then, just help promote businesses in town?
Well, I think once they can see a vision of a realistic date,
they'll be able to.
The programs to promote it are going to be tremendous.
Big signs out there, right? Digital signs.
From a construction point of view, and that's where our interaction is mostly now, construction engineering, they're moving along and they appear to be on schedule. From a marketing perspective, they haven't really,
and I'm sure they
answered the questions about when or who to call or things like that.
But I'm sure they have a plan, Dave.
I'm sure they do.
That's all I have.
Skate Park Committee had a meeting. Mm-hmm. Not this past Saturday, but a week and a half ago. We have just added a skate park page to the township website for the committee itself, so that we could identify the progress that has been made and kind of the points of discussion that have gone back and forth, so that there's a place that people can go and kind of get the information about, what the steps in the process are. Because mm-hmm. that seems to be one of the things that, I know that they were trying to do that on their own website, but they are a committee of council, so mm-hmm. we'll do that on our website as well.
Yeah, and you know what, Dave, one more thing. I'm sorry that Joe Wells stepped out, because when I was reading a lot of the history, on the bike path and all that, all the years that have gone on, I noticed that Riverdale was part of this, and they're no longer part of this. And we
got tired of waiting.
No. I think it has something to do with politics.
Same thing.
No.
And is there a way to reach back to them? Is that us, or would that be the county? Like, who would initiate that conversation with the new
county property?
Because it would be nice if it was all really.
The county would need to be involved if there's interest on their part.
Mm-hmm.
It might be appropriate for some of you to contact some of the political mm-hmm. counterparts in Riverdale.
Is it just going to extend the project?
Yeah, it's going to make timelines.
We'll wait till we're done. But it was weird, because as I was reading it, I hadn't quite realized that, because I was reading it was reported in the newspaper so many miles or whatever, and then I read, and then the miles were less, and I was like, what happened?
I think the county, in the back of their mind, always has not made active provisions, but kind of thought that at some point Riverdale might
come back.
So I don't think it's that far out of the.
Do you know why they stepped away?
They got to build a bridge.
Yeah, it was political in nature. Yes. Yeah,
okay. All right, that's it. I'm done.
Okay. Last Tuesday, I attended the middle school graduation. Last Wednesday, a bunch of us attended the high school graduation. That all went well. Fair housing met the same night as the high school graduation. I was unable to attend that because of that meeting. Fireworks will be this Thursday, June 30th. I think that is there an exact time or just dusk?
8 p.m.
The fireworks.
That's what fireworks
for. Typically.
Well, you get there at 8 p.m. and start to get dark.
Typically, fireworks go off shortly after 9.
Yeah. So, June 30th. At the high school for the fireworks. Should be a good show. So anyone that can attend, please attend. And that's all I have. Next on the agenda is public comment. If anyone wishes to address the council, please wait to be recognized. Come to the microphone and provide your name and address for the record, Tom.
Thank you, Mayor. Tom Andreas, 6 Elm Road, Pompton Plains. With the door ordinance, is there a time between when Bob makes the draft ordinance and before the next council meeting, that the public could see that draft ordinance so they could make more intelligent comments at the council meeting?
You'll see it next council meeting.
Well, we can publish it with the agenda.
Yeah, it gets published with the agenda.
That's the same time we see it as well.
I'm just asking, you know, because it'd be a shame if we just see it the night of the council meeting. You know, it's hard to read it and make good comments. But if we can see it before the council meeting, you know, we can read it and make better comments at the council meeting.
Posted the Friday before, is that correct?
We generally just post the outside so they don't see the specific ordinances.
Could you post the ordinance this time with it?
Yeah, can you put it with it this time?
Would that be?
Yeah, I can do that. I don't know that. It might be easier if there were a list of people if I could email it to them.
The ordinance process is set up the way it is, so that it is published before the public hearing, which is where the public is actually supposed to provide their meaningful input after having read it.
What does before the public meeting mean? Does that mean a half hour, or does that mean a day?
No, well, I mean that after introduction, there's then a requirement that the ordinance be published in the paper.
Okay.
I mean, that's where we're broadcasting to the world that this is under consideration, and please come talk about it at the public hearing, which is always the second date after introduction.
So you'll have two meetings.
Right. All right, so we won't see it before the next meeting, but it'll be available after the next meeting, council meeting.
Well, from the meeting on, then you have 2 weeks to...
To read it over and make comments. So you're not going to get much intelligent comment at the next council meeting from the public, then that's all.
Hopefully, Tom, it's all worked out.
I have no doubt, Dave. Thank you all very much.
Any other questions from the public, comments from the public? Joe?
Joe Jorgensen, 14 Meyer Place. Just a quick question on the proposed location of the skate park in Washington Park. What year was that? That dump remediated, or a range of when that was remediated? Mid-70s?
I'd be guessing. I would say somewhere between mid to late 70s, but I just don't have that.
Are you talking about the dump where the grass and the leaves and everything?
No. That was right where you're proposing to put the skateboard park. Used to be the township. No, it was before it was recycling. It was the township dump where Board of Ed used to dump desks and fluorescent light bulbs, and people were allowed to bring refrigerators and all kinds of stuff. And what's that? No. Believe me, because when I was a kid, I used to ride my bicycle down there, and we used to break the fluorescent light bulbs like lifesavers, and find a lot of good treehouse material. But I've never seen anything. I don't even know if that's been remediated. Has that been filled in on top of all that stuff? Because this is one question that you should be asking yourself.
The BMX track was there in the early 80s.
Yeah, but that's on top of the dump.
So well before that.
Because there was a lot, that whole corner. Do you remember where the telephone bins for the different colored glass were? That was right on top of the dump. And that dump was a low spot that was marshy, that was filled in with stuff from the town. So I don't know if I'm opening a can of worms, but I don't want to see you building a skate park on top of 8 feet of fill. You know, because that's why I think I'd asked you, Jay, too, when that was remediated. I never got an answer. So if I put in an OPA request for 1970 to 1980, on that piece of property, will I get any kind of information?
If we have it, I wouldn't even know where to start to look for it. So,
because I think that's a real important thing. You don't want to be putting a kid's facility on top of... You know, when we did the community garden, we made sure that we had core samples or soil testing to make sure there was nothing in that soil. Even though we're not planting in the soil that's underneath that, it's all raised bed and it's controlled soil. We went through the due diligence of making sure that the site was clean. That there's been a lot of activity on that one piece of property that you're talking about, from the recycling, the BMX track, the recycling, and then the dump, which goes back to the 60s, basically. It might have even went back before that.
Yeah,
Well, we had planned to put a ball field there.
Yeah, well, that's why I hope that...
Yeah, I thought there were samples.
We would have due diligence to make sure that that ground is all clean.
Yeah.
We do have some subsurface borings, and we have surface testing from the entire site, which was done... Yeah, part of the reason that the flat field took as long as it did is because of the material on top contained millings, which was considered to be contaminated soil. And I mean, we went round and round with that for the better part of 2 years before we finally got it resolved. But we do have clean surface soil sampling from the entire site, and we have a limited number of borings that were done.
How deep were the borings?
Oh, Tommy, I don't remember.
And what's how deep is the subsurface test?
Again, it's 8 or 9 years ago, so I don't recall.
Yeah, that's
it. It was done as part of all the site work and the survey work that was done for the entire master plan.
Okay.
So, Joe, the ground wouldn't be stable
if
we were to build something on that?
If you saw the stuff that was there,
it was
a lot of wood products, a lot of metal products. It was, you know, every time they changed the desks at one of the schools, they all ended up there.
So that potentially would be a soft area.
Yeah, it was.
You would have put a concrete pad
because
on that.
I was under the understanding that at some point that stuff was all remediated. It was all dug out and taken out. But I'm not too confident that happened. So,
well, and part of the next step, you know, the design and engineering will include, you know, soil, you know, borings and testing to make sure it's going to be able to support whatever's proposed there. So we will take a look at that in closer detail for the area that is proposed to be used to make sure that it's going to support what it's there.
Okay, well,
we would need to look at that regardless of where we went. I mean, one of the reasons that the location at Greenview in the back corner was really determined to be way too expensive is because that it weren't.
Yeah, that's the problem with the tennis courts. That's why the tennis courts keep
exactly.
That's not stable soil over there.
so we already know that that's not. So we have to go through the process to make sure that. And we would have to do that if we were looking at a ball field too. So
right.
I mean,
yeah. Well, I just have them do deep soil borings because that land is substantially higher. Because I mean, we had dirt stockpiled there. Little by little, that has grown because that used to be all swamp. You know, you say there's wetlands in the one corner. That whole thing originally was wetlands. You know, it was all cattails, and that's where they dumped all the stuff in that swamp. So you're saying there's probably no records. Or how would you find that?
It's amazing what they did years ago.
Yeah, off the top of my head, I've been through the attic a couple times. I've never seen any specific records on it.
Yeah, so that confirms that I don't think it ever was cleaned up. It was just filled over.
That would be my bet.
And it was a big area. It was a huge area. It was basically that hole where the recycling area was and also into where the BMX track was. It was a big horseshoe area, similar to the brush place back by the Boys and Girls Club. That was a big area back there, too, where they used to bring all the brush and everything. But this was really, it was a dump. It was stuff that they didn't, if they didn't pick it up at the curb, you could bring it there and throw it. Nobody, it wasn't patrolled or anything else. You just dumped there. So, I hope I'm not opening up a can of worms, but you also don't want to put a kid's facility on top of something that's going to come back and haunt you. Okay, thank you.
And any other public comments?
Louise. Louise, you were late. You were late.
In order for my son-in-law to come, I had to watch the children.
Oh.
That's a family affair. Louise Marchese of 16 Roland Road. Just for GP, we moved in 86, so it had to be 86 or 87. My son used to go on that bike track because by 88, he was skateboarding. Just thought I'd throw that in. Okay. The old saying, things have to get worse before they get better. I thought it had stopped, but now it started up again. Down by the railroad tracks on my end of town, Pequannock end of town, we've had numerous vehicles there over the years for sale, broken down cars for sale, cars that even had Confederate flags on them for sale. Now we have an Army vehicle.
Oh yeah, I did see that.
Who's selling them?
If it's private property, I don't think we can do anything about that.
I brought it up in the past, and that's what I've been told. But what I'm getting at, isn't there something that says you just can't run whatever kind of business you want out of your residence? You know what I'm saying?
Private property.
Yeah, the question is, when does it become a used... You clearly can't have a used car dealership out of your residence.
Because...
When does it become that?
Didn't we just have the situation with the dollhouse thing on the North Pompton Turnpike? There was an issue about that.
That was a business.
Isn't that kind of falling under the same thing? Like, can anybody just decide they're going to make their lawn a car dealership? Exactly.
You can't make it a car dealership, but how many does he have? I pretty much
have to say he only does one at a time, to my knowledge.
That's where the problem comes.
One car for sale does not make a used car dealer.
It's not a car, it's a military vehicle.
Yeah, I don't know where the heck he could have got it.
Is that the same one that was here at the street fair?
No.
So he has it out there right now for sale.
Right.
It's
the
township resident.
So.
I'm trying to think what I can use it for.
So there's nothing we can do. Okay, thank you for listening.
It's on Cosmos.
Is that where it is?
Cosmo and Terza. I believe.
Sorry.
Any other public comment?
No.
Another.
There's no minutes to approve, so we're going to go to closed session.
I'll make a motion to go to closed session.
That's everything.
Very close session.
Call right there. Okay.